You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. Almost forgot my own name there. That's not a good sign for an episode. So for those that are up to date on the old social medias, this has been recorded on the Monday after WrestleMania. I was an idiot and stayed up to watch it, as you may have found out in the week before episode with Meat Factory. So we're running on empty, but we're in for a good time. I think that's the way we're going to go for it. I am joined on this episode by someone who was formerly hellbound and hellbent, but now the modern day gentleman himself. It is Zachary Swift. Welcome to the show.
Hello, sir. How are you today? Other than being a rather sleepy boy.
I'm a very sleepy boy, but we're okay. We're gonna go through because I had to get you on at some point on this podcast, and I'm glad we arranged it. And my own lack of remembering dates may got to assert me. We may get 40 minutes in, and you'll be on your own as I've just killed over, but it's fine. They'll stop recording at some point, I'm sure.
We will make it through together. I have coffee, and we'll power through. We'll power through, Mr. Strachan.
I was going to have an energy drink with me, but I had two last night, and now I'm 33. That just, my heart doesn't cope with that. I'm on Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper Zero. That's the hardcore stuff that I'm on.
There you go. Today. There you go.
Anyway, right. So, first time I've had you on the podcast. So we always do the cliche question first, which I'm sure you've done already because you've been on the Soul Sessions with Soul, an episode that's probably on our archive of audio stuff somewhere. But it's still the cliche question, though. How did you become a fan of professional wrestling?
I think, and it's probably a very cliche answer, I think I just always liked wrestling from a young age. I think I've always been like a performer. I went to my high school that I went to was a performing arts school. So I did loads of theatre growing up. I did lots of performance. So it kind of ties in nicely to that. Like I really, really enjoy the pomp and the pageantry of professional wrestling as much as I enjoy the in-ring. You know, I really like the competition and the grappling and the strategy that goes on in between the ropes. But like, I love the pageantry. I love the entrances, the music, all of these, you know, that's what makes wrestling so amazing for me.
That's it. And nowadays, I think you can be, maybe not in two camps, certainly, but there is that people like the work rate, like the fancy moves and all that kind of stuff. But there's others that just like the family friendly nature of it, where it is the spectacle and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I've kind of flip flop myself depending on the time and place, but you can get into it. There's been matches I've seen that have been like, what happened today? What was the moves? No idea. How did you feel? I could tell you everything I felt in that match, but I could not tell you a single move that happened in it. You know, that kind of way. Do you remember what your first kind of memories, your first favorites were?
Yeah, I mean, so I was thinking about this morning, actually, ahead of sort of coming on. I did a little bit of preparing with my morning routine, and I was thinking, and I was like, when I was very young, like six, seven, eight, that sort of age, it was the Hardy Boys. It was Team Extreme. I was Matt Hardy and my friend was Jeff Hardy, you know, in that sort of age. And then I distinctly remember being furious at Edge and Christian when they masqueraded as the Conquistadors. Maybe that's why I hate Lucha Libre. maybe I just discovered the core of my trauma. I remember being furious about that as a child growing up. That's one of my earliest memories of wrestling. But then you sort of fast forward a little bit to showing my age here. I'll be about 12. And like Evolution, Randy Orton, Backlash, Mick Foley. That's like my real, like when I think of wrestling, that's the match I always go back to that like ignited my love for it.
We're in around the same kind of area then of age. I'm a little bit older. And just for anyone who's watching this on the video feed, I am very aware there's a big green line down my face. It's fine.
It's back. Oh, the line.
It's reappeared. We're going to persevere, though. Just close your right eye. You'll be fine. just look at Zachary. Just look at him. That's the best thing to do.
Line might jump to my screen at one point. We'll see how we grow.
If it does, something's haunted, and I'm not. And I'll be very scared. So we're right about the same age then, because we said the Hardy Boys. Just to compliment you, I didn't think that the Hardy Boys in that era would be the one you'd pick up. I thought it would be their like return to WWE the second time, like 2006 kind of time that one. So right about the Conquistadors time, so it's 2001.
Yeah.
Was that then?
I would have thought in my head that's earlier, but perhaps, you know, at that age, I suppose it's all a bit of a blur.
It might be 99, but it was definitely
that. Yeah, I was born in 1999. I was born in 92, put it that way. So I did, but perhaps, you know, it's all a bit of a blur, that sort of childhood.
It really is. I'm 1990, so if pretty much I kind of go by the background. If it looks a little bit brighter, it's 2002 onwards. If it's a bit dingier, but not too dingy, it's like 2000, 2001, super dingy. Yeah. It's patched era. I go by colors, it seems, at this stage. Like, I don't remember dates, so I'll just go colors. Oh, that's right about that.
For sure.
So yeah, big Hardy Boys fan here. I was Jeff, because I like to climb things. So my mate was Matt, because he didn't. That was kind of the way it worked. So yeah, big Hardy Boys fan here. So we're all in good company. So yeah, hard. I'm all in talking about Hardy Boys, but we won't do that the whole time. So from that point onwards, then I'm just gauging the age here. So that's fine. We've got similar kind of interests and likes and in gaps. And I don't know, I've said this many times on this podcast, but I have had people come on here going, "Oh, who's your favorite?" And they go, "Oh, Jeff Hardy." I'm like, "Ace." "Oh yeah, I remember seeing him first time get CM Punk." No, you've aged me terribly right in one moment. So yeah, it's just the colors, like you say, the pageantry, the Hardy Boys especially, they didn't have like the colorful gear that was all black usually, but they had the big colorful hair and the big moves and the spectacularness of them.
It was Randy, I said this to Sol on his podcast as well, but it was Randy Orton's shower of sparks, you know, on his entrance.
Oh, the golden shower, yes.
Yeah, the shower, that blew my mind as a child. I want that one day. That's like a bucket list thing for me, that I get to do an entrance with the shower, the golden shower, that's something very different.
Careful how you word it.
Yeah. The curtain of sparkles, perhaps, is best to put it.
Like Coach Andy, I like to have a golden shower when I go to this match.
Yeah, I don't know. We do a lot of family-friendly shows. I'm not sure that's appropriate.
Yeah, nightclub, I'm sure. Anyway, no, we're going into a dark path we don't want to go into. So from that point onwards then, so that's a big gap between you pursuing it, as far as I'm aware, pursuing it and watching it. So in between that time, was there ever a gap? Were you always all in on wrestling? Was there
No, I dropped out like many people do. I think, you know, I probably dropped out not long after that sort of Evolution era. I sort of have memories of, you know, into like Eddie versus JBL, John Cena's Thuganomics, all of this sort of period, right? Mm-hmm. And then I think perhaps just as a teenager, you know, wayward youths and all that, there's other things that I'd like to spend my time doing and going out and doing all sorts of nonsense. So I sort of fell away from wrestling for a long time, actually. Say, you know, from about 15 to about, like I say, maybe about 5 years ago. And I picked back up wrestling through YouTube videos of, you know, like lists where they're like top 10 times this happened. And sometimes, you know, like botches and all this, those sort of like little videos, the sort of behind the curtain videos. And that's where I got really fascinated by like the works and the smoke and mirrors and like how wrestling works. As I said, like I was a performer, I did a lot of theater. So, you know, there's some real overlap in the sort of things that we do and the performance and this, you know, setting up shows and all these kind of things. So I got really invested in sort of the how and the why. And then yeah, that sort of drew me to giving it a go in, when did I start training? 2021. Summer of 2021 I started.
So we're looking at about coming up to 3 years since I mean, there's that weird. I know that's just after pandemic, so that's just an all or nothing thing. But before we get onto the wrestling start properly for you, we'll go back to the performance side of things. So, you said you did theater things. Was that kind of? I don't know if when you were younger you thought, well, maybe I won't be able to be a wrestler, but I still want to do the performance stuff. So was that kind of your outlet for it? You can still do the creativity things, creative side, but maybe not be able to pursue that dream of being a wrestler at the time.
Yeah, I suppose. Cause I mean, I wanted to be a wrestler when I was like 8 years, 9 years old, when I was Matt Hardy, you know? And I think a lot of us wanted to be wrestlers, but I do have a memory of trying to Google wrestling schools when I was like 13, and they're just I'm from rural Northumberland, just over the border, and there was just nothing. I think there may have been one in Carlisle, if you're familiar with that. Is sort of it was about an hour and a half's drive from where I live, and my mother was adamant that that was not happening, and I think you probably had to be 18 as well, I imagine. And then yeah, the high school I went to, it was a for all intents and purposes like a regular high school. But they specialized in performing arts. So we had like a dance studio, we had a purpose-built theater, and every year we put on two shows, a winter show and a summer show. And my school was interesting because if you played sports, if you were a footballer or rugby was kind of a big sport, again, we're sort of countryside farmers, you weren't particularly cool. If you were a boy and you could sing, and you could dance, you were the coolest guy in school. So yeah, it was a bit of a glee school in some ways. It was a very different upbringing. So that sort of just took me into the theatre side of the world, you know, because everyone wants to be cool, I suppose. So yeah, it's just what we did.
It's a real High School Musical story kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. For sure. So, not quite.
I just sort of forgot about wrestling, I suppose. Mm. I don't think there was ever a moment where I was like, I don't want to be a wrestler anymore. I don't like wrestling anymore. You know, things just sort of fall away. And like I say, it sort of happened to come back around by chance. So
the lists brought you back. I'm assuming things like your walk cultures and all that kind of stuff. That seems to be a thing that a lot of people get brought back into with is those lists. And lists are still popular today. I love writing them. Even though a lot of the times I do write them, I just go, right, I've written 10 names. Sweet. Give a reason. No, that's the list. You take my word for it, guys.
I think it's entirely your prerogative as the proprietor of Scott Rest Network to give your subjective opinion on things. I think that's perfectly okay to have an opinion to be your opinion. Wrestling is subjective anyway.
It is, certainly.
It's inherently subjective. So I'm sure my favorite wrestler isn't the same as your favorite wrestler. Your best wrestler in the world isn't the same as my best wrestler in the world. I think it's okay to be, to differ, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it would be a boring world if we all supported the same people, full stop. I mean, there will be exceptions to the rule. If you support a certain wrestler that's just the absolute dirt worst in general, you like, I'm judging you a little bit for liking that particular person, but you know, generally.
I flat out hate all luchadors. So, you know, that's a hard rule for me. But other than that,
it seems to be quite a common occurrence on this podcast. I think I've had James Blair on the podcast before, and he's save your knees mission statement to try and stop these luchadors from high flying. But
dippy dippy dipshits, I call them.
So I do have a question about that a little bit, but we're still getting to the journey of Zachary Swift first.
Yes, of course.
Yes. So you put it aside, you got back into wrestling through the lists, you got back into it through YouTube, which it's an incredible medium. Even though the algorithm is absolutely all to whack, especially for our YouTube view count, audio is fantastic. Don't know what happened to the video. It was amazing and then it died. But maybe it's because I've got these tech issues and I just don't know how to.
Perhaps it's the green line.
It's the green line. The green line, that's the killer. So you got back into it. Were you aware of a local scene to you? So Northumberland, you mentioned Carlisle, so Target's round about there. Were you aware of a local
not area? Growing up, I didn't even know indie wrestling was a thing. I didn't, you know, like, I had never heard of Ring of Honor until a few years ago. I remember hearing about TNA, but only like, or seeing it on like the weird TV shows on Sky. You know, it was on one of the weird channels, wasn't it?
Challenge
or Brave or yeah, one of those. But I remember it had a six-sided ring. That's all I really knew about it. But yeah, I didn't really know. I didn't know independent wrestling existed really at all. I wasn't familiar with it at all. I only found out about it kind of up here through ICW.
Right.
That was the first wrestling show I ever went to. It was ICW.
Do you remember who's on it?
Yeah, it was a Christmas show. It was maybe it'll have been, therefore, I suppose it would either be December 2018 or 2019. Perhaps 2019. And the main event was a Christmas death match. And there was a Christmas tree wrapped in barbed wire. It was the Kings of Catch, I believe.
I think I've seen a picture of it. It was a Spaceballs event.
I think it was just a fight club. I don't know if it had a special name. Perhaps it did.
Because I think I remember seeing it can't be 2019 then, because the one I'm thinking of anyway, because I remember a picture of Drew with a Christmas tree, but that can't be it. 2018. Yeah, let's find out while I scroll here. ICW is their first kind of exposure to independent wrestling. That's a bit of an interest. That's a bit of a left field thing if all you knew really beforehand was WWE and that kind of thing, because even ICW in 2019 was very, like, in comparison, a bit dirtier, a bit more intimate.
Terrifying.
Because if I've learned good shows myself, it's quite a scary experience, especially if they get a bit too close. Let's see what we've got. December 2019, we've got Gonzo 2. That's Liam Thompson, Kez Evans. So can't be that. Who knows at this point, because they started taping them in weird orders. So
maybe
we've got,
2018.
Oh, was it Crowbar versus Looking Sharp?
No.
Who knows? We'll find out eventually in the near future. It'll come to you in the middle of the night, probably. You'll go, it was that guy. We'll forget about it for now. So that was your first taste of independent wrestling, was a death match in the garage in Glasgow. How did you end up stumbling upon it? Was it just finding the poster? How did you end up there?
I wish I could tell you, but I don't know. Not sure. Honestly, I'm not sure. Probably through social media, you'd imagine, right? Because, ICW was huge a few years prior to it. So perhaps I saw it probably through YouTube, probably through lists, probably that way, but... I can't honestly recall. I did drag my wife to it though, who was not a wrestling fan, who has since I've converted her. She likes watching me wrestle. She likes to watch me wrestle. I'm not sure I would call her a wrestling fan herself, but I dragged her along and she was bewildered by the whole thing, as you can imagine.
I've been there myself. Brush Another Goose, Christmas Death Match, Kings of Catch versus The Purge, main event.
That's the one.
Got Andy Wilde versus Mark Coffey. Joe Henry versus BT Gunn. Jesus. Wolfgang King Williams, Joe Coffey, Liam Thompson. What a card. This is a NXT UK card.
Joe Coffey was immediately my favorite wrestler. That I saw. I thought he was incredible.
That's some card there. Taking your wife to shows. I did that a few years ago. She doesn't watch it. I don't know if your wife's the same. Don't watch it on telly. Not that fussed about it, but she'll go see it live and get enamored by the entertainment side
of
things.
That's exactly the same. Yeah, for sure. She'll never watch it on television. She'll leave the room if I'm watching some wrestling. She comes along. She comes along to my shows, and she does. She enjoys them. At first, I thought she was perhaps telling me she was enjoying them, but I think she genuinely does. Because there's been a couple of recent shows where I've said, you don't need to come, it's fine. Like, she got busy, you're busy with work or this sort of stuff. And then, no, she's like adamant that she wants to come because she really enjoys it. So,
yep. So, again, similar backgrounds here. It's last year, for example, WrestleZone, ding, 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 for anyone to keep his score. I've mentioned them. So they had the Regal Rumble, Kill Valhalla won it. And I had bought tickets to Avenue Anarchy that year. And as soon as Caleb won, my wife turned to me and went, so we're getting tickets then for Avenue Anarchy. We're just going to get two tickets now. All right. Okay. I was going to wait, but all right. I'm not going to question this any further. You said you want to go. I'm going. Get me a ticket now.
Converted by the Viking.
That's he's a very handsome man. It's only natural.
A handsome Viking.
Only natural. So from that point then, you saw ICW. that's still a couple of years between you seeing it and then pursuing it. How did that come about?
So I enjoyed going to independent wrestling. So I like the atmosphere, and I enjoyed watching the matches themselves, of course. But I live in Edinburgh. Just for those who don't know, I suppose, why would anyone know who's listening? But yes, I live in Edinburgh. So I started going to Discovery shows. And I think I went to perhaps two or three Discovery shows. And that's where I saw Andy wrestling for the first time. Well, actually, I saw him on the ICW show, but I don't particularly remember seeing him, you know. Mm-hmm. But then I sort of got familiar with him and his wrestling and his name and stuff through going to Discovery a couple of times. And I think maybe through that, I saw that he had a wrestling school. And I actually wanted to join earlier, but with COVID, I couldn't. I think I reached out to them perhaps in the summer of 2020 and asked about coming to train. And they said, sorry, we're closed at the moment because of COVID. And then, I got pushed back a while, and they said to get back in contact. And then I was on a wait list. I think the classes were perhaps full. I was on a wait list for a little while. And then I got an email being like, can you come to training this week or next week? Or I think it might even be tonight. And I sort of just jumped at the chance. It's fine. For the first 3 months of training, it was non-contact because of the COVID regulations. Mm-hmm. But it actually really helped with ring positioning. Learning to wrestle without actually any physical contact, you really get a better idea of how to move around the ring and your positioning and your footwork, mm-hmm. Which has really helped me become a much better wrestler. I think it was a good way to start. Although, albeit quite unusual.
When it came to sending that email, then was it a case of maybe this could be your last chance to start? Because you hear the stories of people that are a bit older starting wrestling, mm. like your Batistas, your DDPs, and all that kind of stuff. And I suppose at that point, what, 2020, you pursued it, so you were 18? No, 28.
28. Yes, I would have been 28.
So it's not old, but maybe to start, it's a little bit on the longer in the tooth side of things. So yeah. when the pandemic happened, was it just a case of, right, I'm going to have to try this now or I'll never do it?
I suppose so. I think I've always liked a challenge. I've always liked sports. And I've done, you know, from an early age, I was in a basketball club and then I was in a tennis club. I played rugby for about 4 years. I was in a football team. And then I was in a five-a-side football league. And then kind of the most recently, I was a runner. I did a lot of running. I did a lot of half marathons around the UK. And I really enjoyed running, but it's very solitary. And I wanted to get back into a sort of sport that involved other people. So I was sort of, you know, seeing what was out there. And I thought perhaps I would give wrestling a chance. Yeah, there was a little bit of, not my sort of last chance to do this, but that kind of moment of doing something you've always wanted to do. And I think if you ask most wrestlers, there's a little level of, not embarrassment, I'm certainly not embarrassed to be a wrestler, I'm happy to tell everyone I'm a wrestler, but I think when you're first getting into it, there is perhaps a stigma to professional wrestling. Mm-hmm. So I think for a long time, I'd sort of shied away from that, I suppose. Perhaps I cared too much of what people thought of me. So there was this moment of, yeah, just sort of, thinking, why not? Let's just give it a go. But I remember when I first emailed Andy and Hannah, who have this school, my first question to them was, I asked what the average age of the class was. Because I was nervous about the age. I had this vision in my mind of me turning up to this wrestling school of like 16, 17-year-olds. And I'm, you know, nearly twice their age. And feeling really sort of not like I don't belong there. But I mean, even to this day, Power Pro trains from 5-year-olds to 45-year-olds. It is a huge mix. Obviously, not all together. We're not sort of powerbombing 5-year-olds. But that surprised me about wrestling, that there is it's ageless, right?
Yeah. I've just got the vision of you just going, right, you, how old are you? 6, powerbomb. That's just,
yeah. It's great for practice moves. they're light. You can pick them up. You can move them around.
I've just mentioned basketball. We've already mentioned the stage school stuff. You, the Troy Bolton of professional wrestling. If obviously cooler.
I was asked to leave the basketball team for being too rough, and that's when I started playing rugby instead. The basketball coach suggested I play rugby instead of basketball. So, oops.
so you started training then. you said you're a big sporty guy anyway, so the contact rugby player, that's not going to be a humongous stretch for you. Running stamina's already in there. You're getting taught the basic footwork and that. So did you feel like you kind of took to it quite quickly? Was there anything that you initially were trepidatious about? Or was that a case of once you got to the contact stuff, that's when it started to feel a bit more real?
Yeah, I mean, like you say, I've always been active. I've always been in sports, especially with running and stuff. So I felt sort of physically fit to do it. But I think it's the biggest thing that non-wrestlers don't understand about wrestling is just how hard it is. It is so physically demanding. I couldn't believe it when I first started. I thought, you know, I run a lot, I can do this. I can run half marathons pretty much, you know, on the flip of a coin. This won't be a piece of piss, but you know, I feel fully capable and able to do this. But it is, even to this day, you know, you run drills and sequences in training and you are blown up and you are gasping for breath. It is the most physically demanding sport I've ever taken part in. So I think that was a bit of an adjustment period for me. I think I took to it relatively well, perhaps not as natural as some others. I think I did have some trepidation about hurting people initially, mm-hmm. Which is quite, you know, I suppose in rugby you would hurt someone, you know, you tackle someone, bring them down, but you know, this is a combat sport and it's the first time I've ever done a combat sport and, you know, striking someone and, you know, actively aiming to maim and hurt, and not injure, but you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Put someone down is a little hurdle to get past. I'd say I'm past it. I quite enjoy it now, I must admit. but initially, I had a lot of trepidation. I can't say, I think I've never really punched anyone in the face, you know, until I did wrestling.
Right, then okay.
Get in the ring, and today we're learning punching people in the face, and it's an unusual moment to find yourself in.
Mm-hmm. So it's like going home and getting asked, "Oh, what did you do today?" "Oh, we spent 3 hours doing short burst running, and then I punched people in the face. That was my day."
That's wrestling. Yeah. Well, I mean, I sort of come home quite regularly with sort of black eyes and cut lips and all sorts, and my wife just shakes her head at me.
but you mentioned, like, the long distance running being you can do it at a drop of a coin, which I probably never have that in my skill.
That's what I was meant to say. I said a flip of a coin, and as soon as I said it, I was like, I don't think that is the same. It's drop of a coin.
We're on the same wave. It's all good. I suppose for wrestling, even though I've never done it, it's more short bursts, isn't it? So you're more up down sharp movements in comparison to running, which is kind of constant. Generally a constant speed, you've got a rhythm with your feet and all that kind of stuff. I imagine, I say here as a rotund gentleman sitting in my office chair. last thing I ran for was when I thought, oh god, the Chinese is almost shut. So it's a different and an interesting sport. And then you run the ropes as well, which I always hear is kind of a killer if you're not prepared for it, as well, because they're a lot harder than you think they're going to be. Again, I imagine. I've held a rope. I've never actually hit one. So that's
when I first started training, I remember I'd come home and I'd have huge lines across my back that were like sort of bruises and cuts from running the ropes. From running them badly without correct technique. And also, I think just that part of my body not being used to that sort of physical contact, you know. But yeah, it can get you.
So from that point onwards, so 2021, we're in here now, started training. And your debut was... I didn't write down the date, because why would I do such a thing? That would be silly. Was it the next year? It was 2022, was it?
Yeah, I would say it was, depending what you sort of classify as a debut, it would be the next year, but it would have been, we did a student show in Glenrothes.
So the July one?
July, yes.
Yep. Right. I do have them. I've written down that. Tag July 2022. So yes. That's an excellent note that I've written down there, which has given me no information other than the day. So when you find out that you're making your debut, even though it's a showcase show, so generally it's friends and family that's in that crowd, and everyone should be supporting each other anyway when it comes to the wrestling side of things. But so there's a little, was there more pressure or less pressure? As someone who's done performance art anyway, did you feel any pressure with that performance performing in front of a crowd?
I just distinctively remember having a really good time. I just really, really enjoyed that show. I really enjoyed the opportunity to do it. I don't particularly remember being nervous about it. I think, in my wrestling ability was in its infancy at that time. So, are you familiar with the graph that sort of goes like the longer you do something, you think you're really good at it, and then you realize you're shit at it, and then you build yourself back up and back up and back up, and then it goes down again. And so, any sort of career, yeah, it gets related to all sorts of different things. I think in wrestling, I was at that first peak. So I was like, I wrestled for about a year. It was my debut. I could do a few moves. I thought I was really good. I didn't really, do you know what I mean? So I was confident and excited. And yeah, I really, really enjoyed that match.
So I've written down tag match. That again has not helped me,
There
but
was a
do you remember what it
six-man
was?
tag.
So yeah, you're sorry, I thought I had written that down, but it's fine. So yeah, so six man tag match, which is again nice, a little bit less pressure as well. There's six of you to work it through. And you felt confident coming out of it. When was the drop then? When was the moment you really went, oh no, this is not this is I need a bit more work in this.
I think perhaps as I started to get further out there and start working for promotions, I think it'll have been the sort of the March of next year in 20 was I 23 then. I worked for Fair City Wrestling, and I also did debut sort of in proper for FPWA, now Power Pro. And they were both shows that featured some incredible wrestlers and some more experienced wrestlers. And I think being around them, seeing them prepare for their matches and the way they sort of strategize and their techniques and everything they do. And also you're probably familiar with the culture of feedback as well. And hearing the feedback given between different wrestlers backstage when the shows were after the people were having their matches and stuff. And I thought there's a lot more to this than I thought, than a couple of backbreakers and a suplex,
When it came to like preparing yourself for the wrestling, so you said you're a big fan of Matt Hardy, and your style doesn't, from what I've seen, doesn't befit that. So it's
No.
more of a striking base. So who's the kind of guys you go and go, right, I need to check out this guy, or who you recommended to go check this guy on YouTube or whatever to kind of hone your moveset.
I mean, I'm not so sure there's a particular person. Do you know Brannigan from Iron Girders?
Yes, yep.
When I met him, he's great. He's a lovely, lovely gentleman. When I met him at an Iron Girders show, the first thing he said to me was like, "You're a fan of Roderick Strong, aren't you?" And I was like, "Yes, as it happens, because I think there's a lot of similarities in our move sets. So perhaps that's someone I have sort of magpied a rather large amount of my move set from." A lot of Eddie Guerrero stuff, Dean Malenko, the clover leaf I'm a big fan of, using that in my matches. And then our dear old friend, Mr. Ian Skinner, regularly sends me little clips and little moves that he suggests. He has been somewhat of a mentor for me, and he's always sending me little clips of moves to try, and I've always been very grateful for those.
I love Ian Skinner. He's a incredible human being. He has asked a question though, so I'll throw it in just now. I think you're probably aware of what the question will be once I start it. So yeah, just as you've mentioned him, we'll segue straight to it. He has
Go
asked, would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games, but no games?
on. That man is as mad as a box of frogs. He truly is. I don't even understand the question.
To be honest, he's asked this. I've had him on 5 times now, and I think he came in came this question came in like the third time I had him on, and I still don't really know or
Run it by
understand.
me one more time.
It is, would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
I'm genuinely flabbergasted. I have no idea, Mr. Skinner. If you're listening, my dear friend, you are a strange but wonderful human being.
I think that's the best way to describe him. That's it. But yeah, we love Ian Skinner on this podcast. The last two episodes of it,
Also,
though.
a shout out for Ian Skinner is looking absolutely massive. Have you seen his arms? He is. Follow, if you look at his social media, that man is packing on muscle like you would not believe.
So less Ian Skinner, more Ian Thicker.
Yeah, there you go. Very good. Yeah, I liked it.
That was not good.
Shake your head. I liked it. It was witty. It was witty.
Okay, I'll take your word for it. But yeah, so Ian Skinner is wonderful. Anyway, enough about him. He's got five other podcasts that we've had him on. Last two was just movie based, really, because we gave up speaking about wrestling a long time ago. So from that point onwards, you made a debut, like say you mentioned Fair City Wrestling, which I suppose is a little bit of a different kind of crowd. We mentioned FPWA, which I think, from what I've gathered anyway, it's a very like wrestling crowd, as in they want to see some good wrestling. They want to see some good that. But Fair City's character, it's more,
yes,
give me an entertaining moment to remember and all that kind of stuff. So
I agree. I also disagree, I suppose. I think there's the Fair City wrestling crowd, they definitely like the characters, but I think there are a lot of older fans that go to Fair City Wrestling that really appreciate good quality wrestling as well. Well, I think down at Power Pro, we have some of those fans, but I'd say we're more family friendly. I think we're more of a family oriented show, perhaps.
Okay. Fair. I suppose the more important thing with wrestling, it has to be variety. So it will obviously have to verge into both at some point, you would think, to catch the widest net of fans to come back each time.
Yeah.
Did you start off were you good guy, bad guy? Where were you starting off there?
I mean, I sort of, when I started wrestling, I just wanted to be a professional wrestler. And that sort of led me down a path of, I guess I didn't really consider, I didn't want to cheat to win. I didn't want to do anything nefarious. I wanted to wrestle. I wanted to compete against people, you know, try my best and see how I could do, which I guess sort of naturally puts me in sort of the good guy category as such. And then I guess even just only nearly 3 years in, I found myself just being a little bit bitter about the opportunities some people get in wrestling. And I just think perhaps I need to take more dramatic steps to get where I need to be now. I'm a little bit more ruthless in my wrestling. I found it is necessary to be ruthless.
Finding out you need to maybe work smarter than harder in some respects. Fair, absolutely fair. So I've seen the matches that you had. Unfortunately, you've not been caught up by the Germans yet. No cage match profile as yet, but it will eventually come. It's on my big Excel spreadsheet to send over to them. So I think everyone else at the moment is getting them, is me sending them going, can you add this person, please? So I've seen your first official FPWA debut, Power Pro debut, was the Fatal Five Way.
Yes, indeed it was.
And this is a pretty stacked Fatal Five Way. We're looking at it. We've got Levi.
Yep.
We've got Shaheen.
Yes.
Tommy Cartel.
Indeed.
And Ashley Vega.
Absolutely.
That is a hell of a lineup for a Fatal Five Way. So that was March 2023.
Yes.
So now you're making your debut, FPWA debut, and it's, there will be friends and family in the crowd, of course, but it's a little bit more untethered. There'll be more people. Any sliver of embarrassment that you may have had or had left, it has to go. How was that for a debut in your hometown promotion? Your home promotion?
I was really excited about this one as well. I remember I got asked relatively close to the date for the show. So I didn't have a lot of time to sort of prepare for it. But I suddenly I just threw myself into it, full beans in, and gave it my best. And that was an incredible show, because that was the show where we had the guys from New Wave down in Cardiff on the show as well. So it was just, it was an incredibly stacked card with some amazing talent on there. And I felt kind of honored to be within those, you know, considered one of the people to be deserving of a spot on that card. I was definitely a little nervous about it for sure, but no, I enjoyed it.
So this is where we kind of got a proper introduction to you, because I had a little promo as well with you and Tommy Cartel and all that kind of lead up into it. So from that point then, Fair City Wrestling, you were there as well. I did the Fair City Rumble in a junior heavyweight title match. So we've gone from a point where you're in tag matches, rumble matches, and now you're getting lower and lower on the number of people in the ring at this point. But that four-way, as I've seen who was in it, he probably hated it because there was at least one masked guy in there.
Spike Tierney.
So that would set your teeth on edge in the first place. But what was it like getting about on that four-way?
I enjoyed being up at Fair City Wrestling. Again, like you say, a different crowd, a different experience. A very welcoming locker room up there. They are a good bunch. I enjoyed that one. And again, yeah, I was in there with, you know, a couple of veterans, and I learned a lot in that match. I think this is where I started to realize that I would have to bend the rules a little bit and be a little bit more ruthless and nefarious in my actions. You know, that the five-way, I went in there with all intents and purposes of, you know, winning honorably and fairly, and it didn't work. And then the fatal four-way, same again. I tried to be relatively straight down the line, and again, didn't really pay off for me. So this is where I'm starting to learn that wrestling is, you know, you have to bend the rules to get anywhere.
Speaking of masked wrestlers, brought up Spike Tierney there. We do have a question coming in through Facebook from Patrick Tierski, from DAPW.
Yes.
He has asked,
the dancing man, the big dancing man, isn't he?
One half of the I've forgotten the name of their tag team. I've only got MILFs in my head. I don't think it's that.
Something about mothers. Probably a rather inappropriate thing, isn't it?
Not safe for mothers. That's it. I'm just imagining kind of MILF t-shirts. It's not that. Not safe for mothers. That's what they're called. He has asked, will you continue your search for Talon Senior?
Well, this is the thing. In my preparations for my fight against Talon, I wanted to sort of dig into his history to find out really who he is, to find his weaknesses. And of course, his name is Talon Junior. Therefore, I thought there must be a Talon Senior. And I, to this day, have not found a Talon Senior. Not in the archives, not on Cage Match, not in any of the books. I don't believe he exists. I believe Talon Jr. is a charlatan.
I've heard this conspiracy many times about this Talon Senior fella. He's like, just in the, in the shadows, in the auras. I don't know where he could be. But I've heard his name come up a couple times in whispers, where he is and his possible whereabouts.
Prison was one of the things I heard, that he was in prison, but I don't know why, and I can't find any record of him. But I did. It was Robert Balfour from The Par, I believe, let me know that Talon Senior is in prison, but I don't know. I don't know the reasons why.
Well, hopefully we'll find out. We'll find out a bit more of that in the future, because I think that's a question that needs to be answered in the near future.
I think Talon Jr. should come out and tell us where his father is. But the masked man will not speak.
I think we've had him on the podcast before. We may have had him on the podcast before. But before then, I don't think the Talon Sr. conspiracy had started. It was very early on in the podcast infancy. We may have to get Talon Jr. back on. I can grill him properly. We can find out the answers to these questions. So as well as that, you've represented Power Pro FPWA in their like school crossovers with Iron Girders. How important was it for you that you were chosen to represent your home training school in that kind of crossover?
Oh, I was hugely proud, and I think to this day I consider myself the vanguard of Power Pro. I absolutely wear the name as on my chest, you know? I was very proud to represent us. And I was very hopeful to steal a little win over at Girders. And it was very, very, very close. I don't know if you've seen that match.
The King of the Fling?
Yes, I was screwed. I was, Mr. Strachan, I was screwed.
I think you were in final two, weren't you? You were in final two. Is it Daisy had been dispatched and... you're
to
close.
A famous man, that referee was trying to fuck on me. Because he announced that Moxie Malone had been eliminated. But yet she had not. She kept her feet off the floor. But the referee called it, the announcer called it, and said she'd been eliminated. So to my knowledge, she was out of the match. And I eliminated Gabriel. So He went away. I eliminated Daisy Jenkins. That was her. Then that, I should have been the winner. And while I was celebrating on the ropes, Moxie Malone threw me out. So I arguably am the true king of the flame.
There we go. So when this episode comes out, I think this, and then along with the Talon Senior allegations and conspiracies, we need to get to the bottom of this as well. And Iron Girders are going to have to repay in kind and get you into the King of the Fling. You are the lineal true champion. You don't need to be in a match. You've already, technically won it.
Well, I suppose. I mean, technically, Moxie wasn't eliminated. I think the referee just screwed me. So the jury's out a little on that one, but. I'd like another bash.
So, speaking of representing, you also made your recent debut at Community Pro Wrestling, where you in a town where I said it once and it terrifies me to say it again. Artis Haig? I feel terrible.
I have absolutely no idea.
That's good. Makes two of us.
Artis Haig. I have no idea.
Maybe not Ardashag. That's possibly. We're talking about golden showers on this podcast. Don't need that as well.
Yeah.
So you've struck up a bit of a I don't know if it's a momentary alliance or if it's something that will be pursued further between yourself, Thatcher Wright, and Charles Watson.
Yes. Mr. Thatcher gave me a phone call and asked if I could come and help him out with a couple of little brats. I was happy to oblige.
So have you found that you started as Hellbound Heaven Sent, you started as that, and you've evolved yourself into the modern day gentleman. Have you found that the modern day gentleman is more Zachary Swift, is more you?
Yes, I think it's kind of truly who I am. Like I say, I think in the beginning, in the infancy of my wrestling, I was trying to play a character of like the professional wrestler. So I wanted to give myself like a little catchphrase, like, Heaven Sent, Hellbound, all this sort of stuff, you know, kind of like this like James Bondy action man style character. And I think that mask quickly slipped. I think, you know, I want to just, this is, I am a man of gentlemanly pursuits. And I think, you know, I'd like to just convey that in my wrestling.
Well, I noticed you've got a very dashing mustache, and you mentioned the phrase there. Of the referee trying to fuck on you. Is there a little bit of dashing Cody Rhodes in there? Is that a little bit of dashing Cody Rhodes in your kind of endeavors?
Yes, there's a little bit of our lovely friend Mr. Rhodes. Rather large congratulations to him, of course. We'd be remiss in not saying such. There's a little bit of William Regal in there, of course, as well. Well, a little bit of Danielson. You know, I take a lot of inspiration from some of the greats.
And speaking of your nice green moustache, we do still have a discount code for anyone interested. Yes, I've got this advertising stuff. Probably shouldn't celebrate me doing segues. That probably takes away the smoothness of it. It's so rare that it happens. Manscaped.com, go onto their SWN20, get 20% off and free shipping. And you can have a lovely tash like Zachary Swift here. I've clearly stopped using it for my face, but it can be used for other areas.
You look pretty well groomed.
It must be the lighting, but I've used it in other areas, so you don't need to know. We don't need to show that. So you've become the modern day gentleman. You've leveled up. I think by the sounds of it, from you're in the, maybe on the line up on the graph. You're going towards the peak again.
Yes.
You also made a recent appearance at Comic Con as well in Livingston with Frank Gallo and Kate Calloway, who we've had both. On the podcast recently. Where is your kind of goal set now? I would say you're onto that peak of the graph again, and hopefully it's not going to fall down as dramatic or anything like that. But
yeah,
where's your kind of, where's your outset on wrestling right now?
So if we go back to this old graph, I wouldn't say we're at a peak, but we are at the beginning of an ascent. And I think a lot of wrestlers who are around the same sort of level of experience as me, they create these bucket lists of like who they want to wrestle. And they'll sometimes you'll see them on January 1st. They'll put a photo on social media or a little notepad with a list of names. on it, and they're like, this is how they're sort of judging their self-worth and their ability in the ring by the number of matches they had, the number of wins they've had, and the people they wrestled against. I don't think that's a very good way to sort of evaluate your self-worth. And I don't think it's a good way to sort of progress. Like that graph works, you get that huge drop-off. That drop-off sounds like a negative thing, but it's not, because it's that moment of realization that you can improve and there's more to learn. So I have my own little list on my phone, but my list is not wrestlers I would like to wrestle or promotions I would like to wrestle for, but it is called Sitting Under the Wrestling Tree, is what I've called it. And I want to try and train with as many incredible wrestlers this year and try and learn as much as I can and absorb as much knowledge and learn new skills and abilities and new ways to approach professional wrestling. So this year so far, where are we? We are just at the beginning of April. I have, of course, trained with Andy Roberts, Jonathan Gresham, Lana Austin, Liam Slater, Johnny Lyons, Niwa, Wild Boar, and next week we have the Grizzled Young Veterans visiting Scotland. I'll be training with them as well. And I hope to keep continually to add to this list throughout the year, get myself to lots of the wrestling schools around the country, and keep growing as a wrestler right now and becoming as good as I can possibly be.
I was just thinking of an example of that graph that we're talking about here. It's like when you, I said leveling up, which is kind of the kind of key here. It's like when your experience bar goes right to the top and then you hit the next level, it goes right back down to the bottom again. So it's you hitting this new level each time, and it goes back to start again because you're starting at the new level as well. And that's probably at your stage in wrestling, I'll say 3 years since you started training this summer coming up, and that's a very short time in a wrestling career. So to think you've already been on shows, you've been other promotions elsewhere, I think that's quite a logical and possibly a mature list to have, is to go, right, what can I learn, instead of then afterwards it's going, right, I learned from this guy, I can maybe make magic with this guy because I've learned this from this person. So it's a very interesting, let's say, mature way to look at it.
I appreciate your kind words, sir. I think that's the thing. The other mindset, the nugget of information that I'd like to share, is that a lot of trainee and young and big wrestlers in the infancy of their careers are desperate to debut places. You know, that's a real, and it is, it's a massive marker of accomplishment, and people should be very proud of it. You know, I'm really proud that I debuted at Community Pro Wrestling this month, but you only have one opportunity to make an impression. Mm-hmm. And if you get that debut, you get that opportunity at a wrestling, at a promotion too early, and you're not as good of a wrestler as you can be, then you are probably going to get asked to go back to that promotion, you know? And you can burn bridges very quickly. And not in a sort of explosive falling out way, but just you've sort of expired that opportunity. And there aren't that many promotions locally. And if you sort of, you know, you go work for the five promotions sort of within reach of you, and all of them you have, I don't want to call them mediocre matches, but, you know, perfectly, you don't leave a strong lasting impression, and you don't get asked back, where does that leave you, you know?
Absolutely. Do you find it, I had the same conversation with Daisy Jenkins, and it was a case of, because you started a little bit older, at 28, you started a little bit older, you had all the life experience beforehand, you had the going out, and you had all the kind of shenanigans of that you can look at wrestling at a more logical pace like that. You're married, you've done all the grown-up stuff, now you can look at wrestling more as a business possibly than an actual like hobby.
Yes and no. I approach it like a business. I approach it like I have a career working in beverage alcohol. I work for a company called Brown-Forman, as well as my wrestling career. I do a lot of work with Jack Daniels, one of our most famous brands. And I sort of, you know, the way that I progressed through my career there, I sort of, you know, use those same, that same logic and the same sort of ideologies that I've used in that career to my wrestling career. I think that's definitely true. But I think also I'm at a position in my life where I do have a second career, and I don't think I don't think anyone should be ashamed of having another career outside of wrestling. And I all credit to the young wrestlers in this country who want to be professional wrestlers and make their living and their livelihood off wrestling. I think that's a really amazing thing if you're able to do so. I personally am probably not at a position where I could or would like to do that. I would love to be able to wrestle, you know, a couple of times a month. But wrestling for me is something that I enjoy doing. I really enjoy wrestling. And I think some wrestlers are so caught up in trying to make it their career, which is an incredibly difficult thing to do. They don't enjoy wrestling. They're so hard on themselves, in their diet, in their exercise, in giving themselves feedback on matches they've had. And people get really upset and worked up and, you know, frustrated with wrestling. And I think it's so important to enjoy it. We should all enjoy wrestling, you know?
I couldn't agree more. And I'm on the other side of the barrier, of course. And I think that's, especially when we mentioned WrestleMania as well, with Cody Rhodes winning the Universal title. And oh my God, I was not even 12 hours ago and I was in tears watching that. And that's the thing you have to remember is wrestling is supposed to be fun. And yes, we mentioned approach it as a business, but I think doing it that way as well lets you separate it more as well. So you can look at the what you've done and all that kind of stuff. You can put that to one side and then you can do the wrestling going, but I get to do this and this is the thing I want to do. So yeah, it's like I say, very it's a great thing to hear that's your kind of thought process for it. And he mentioned full-time wrestlers. I can maybe think of five if I'm really pressed right now in Scotland that are full-time. And that's, and you have to have a training school and you have to keep that income coming in as well and be able to wrestle at the weekends because you still want to be a wrestler. And it's a very high pressure situation. And at the moment for yourself, you've got that full-time job. You've got the job that's covering all the important things in life and you get to be a wrestler. And sure, at some point, maybe the balance will tip a little bit where you're working less in one place, working more, doing other things. But I think was it Jim Ross that always said was to always have a backup plan or to have an education or always have something to fall back on, because wrestling can, your career, not to put too much pressure and a bit of a downer on this moment, but your wrestling career can end like that.
Yeah.
One thing could happen.
Absolutely. You're totally right. I think, having that plan B is absolutely so important.
I think for yourself as well, you've got that backup as having that performance background. So if this, I don't want to jinx you, and I'm going to touch all the wood that I can, but if all those things could, if something did happen, you've at least got the background of that performance art where you're still an asset to wrestling, I would say. I don't know whether you would still want to be involved if you couldn't do it in the ring, but that's a whole different thing. And like I said, I've versed this podcast was nice and jolly. We talked about golden showers, and now we're talking about serious things. But yeah, it's one of those things where you've still got a baseline asset of performance that would still be a thing that could be used in wrestling. Commentary, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I would. I quite fancy ring announcing. I think I've got a nice voice for it. I would enjoy ring announcement. I'd also quite like refereeing. We do obviously at the training school. We do a lot of training matches and sparring and stuff, which require a referee. And I always quite enjoy refereeing. I get to be in charge, and people have to listen to me, and I quite enjoy that.
So we're not killing your career early though. So that's years
not
in the future.
Yet. Not just yet. No.
A few more things
to achieve.
Just in the infancy. So you mentioned your bucket list is kind of putting that list together of people that you train with. But is there a hidden note in there somewhere that you're like, while you're doing those training sessions and you're seeing the people that you're training with going, yeah, maybe you, I'll put you on my list of maybe if I work on this particular aspect, you're an opponent I'd want to come up against.
Yeah, I suppose so. I think the sort of Venn diagram of people I'd like to wrestle and people that I would like to learn from probably don't overlap hugely. There's definitely some. Liam Slater, of Pursuit Pro Wrestling down in Sheffield, is one of the most incredible wrestlers I've ever seen perform. I think he is like just he complete his philosophy to wrestling is incredible. His ability in the ring is incredible. And I was, like I said, I went down to train with him down at his facility earlier this year. Earlier this year. And I learned so much from him within such a short space of time. And he would be absolutely be a dream opponent. I think he'd probably run rings around me, in all honesty. But I think it would be a great opportunity to wrestle him. In terms of like actual opponents, there's probably, I don't want to say people I don't respect, but there's certainly people I'd like to beat up. And I think that list is, not that I don't respect them, but there's certainly people I'd like to punch in the face.
Speaking of that, as I said before we hit record, I spoke to the guys at Meat Factory last night, and they added a couple questions that they wanted me to ask you. So the first one is, when are they getting rematch? Because yourself and Leon Redfield, maybe thanks in a small part to the par, you defeated them.
Yes.
The Meat Factory.
Well, here's another little nugget of information for you. Zachary Swift and Leon Redfield are the only undefeated tag team at Power Pro Wrestling. So take with that what you will, but I don't really want to ever give them a rematch. They're a pair of big idiots. Big, stupid men. And they don't really respect wrestling. So I don't really want to give them a rematch. They're also very big boys. And I am proudly a cruiserweight. If I'd rather not get thrown around by them. They're like Tweedledum and Tweedledee, the pair of them. So if I get to choose, never is my answer.
Well, that kind of negates the second question I asked, which was, did you like getting battered by Meat Factory?
Yes, very, very good, boys. But I won. Let's not forget the result. My cage match doesn't yet exist, but when it does, it will say win, and they lost. So, but I mean, Craig Berry particularly is a man who I've just taken so much joy punching him in the face. I have crossed paths with him in multiple student rumbles and all sorts of different positions. And he's just such a punchable face. I really enjoyed. Do you know what? I don't particularly want to have a rematch with a pair of them. John Kerr's a relatively terrifying man, in all honesty. But Craig Berry, I'd quite like to punch in the face again. I'd do a singles match with Craig Berry.
There we go. Coach Andy, book it. In the near future, when the Power Pro run their next event. So we've talked about the future. We've talked about the possible opponents and that. I'm assuming companies, as a company that really got you properly invested into wrestling again, Discovery's on that list of pursuits to try and get to. I've heard a lot of good things about Pursuit Pro Wrestling at the moment. They're very active on TikTok, which is how I get all my information nowadays. So I like what they're putting out there. I guess Ian Skinner is possibly on that list of opponents, even though if he sent you all these clips of things to try, he knows what he sent you. There's a little bit of conflict of interest there.
I've done a training match with Ian Skinner once at a seminar, I believe. It was a Noam Dar seminar we hosted at formerly FPWA, and I did a little training match with him in sort of the very early period of my wrestling career, and I learned a lot in that short space of that match. I would love to have another match with him, and I think I'd probably surprise him with my ability now compared to how I was then. I think he ran rings around me pretty easily, and he was rather confident about it. But I think I could perhaps surprise him now. I would love to have a match with Ian Skinner.
There you go. So before we wrap up then, because we've covered about as much as we can about Zachary Swift at this moment in time. For those that want to know more, they can do so. We'll get social plugs in a moment. You did something similar on Soul, so I'm just curious for myself, because I think everyone needs to be a bit of a modern day gentleman, so to speak. What is your top tips for being a modern day gentleman?
Oh, that is a wonderful question. Top tips. For being a modern gentleman, dress immaculately. you know, own at least three suits and make sure they're tailored. Lots of wrestlers have unique body shapes and sizes, so it's important to get your suits tailored. And it's not particularly expensive to get a suit tailored. If you buy a suit and then go get it tailored, I think that's absolutely what all gentlemen should have is a good suit. Drink your martinis ice cold. A good martini is perfect way to spend a gentleman evening with a couple of those. What else? And then I just sort of, you know, pursue gentlemanly pursuits. Whatever they may be for you, I would suggest following them. You know, be a man of culture.
There we go. So for those that are unaware, want to find out more, if they've listened to this and unaware of you, I would be shocked and baffled. But if they want to find out more about Zachary Swift, where can people find out more about you?
I am most active on my Instagram, which is at Zachary Swift Pro. I do have a Twitter, or an X as it is now. I believe that's Zach Swift PW, but I must admit I'm not particularly active on that site. So yeah, Instagram's kind of, I believe I'm on Facebook as well. But Instagram's, that's where I'm at really.
Excellent. And you can find out more about Zachary Swift. But yes, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today. I've learned a lot, so I'm glad that we got this set up. I think there was maybe a 2-minute segment section where I absolutely forgot words, but I think I covered it up quite well. The video might tell me otherwise, but I think I just went into the distance. But I think we did okay.
I think you did admirably. Don't you worry. While this is on the public record, Billy, I want to thank you for all the work that you do for the Scottish wrestling community. It is hugely appreciated. You do this off your own back. And I don't know if anyone ever tells me this, but thank you, because we do appreciate it.
Thank you. I've had a couple compliments last couple. I very much appreciate it. I've had a couple compliments the last couple of days, and unfortunately, because I have crippling imposter syndrome, I'll never believe you. But you keep telling me one day I'll believe someone when they say that I'm doing good stuff. But I'm gonna keep going. I'm gonna keep trying in the meantime. But this has been delightful. I'm starting now because I don't know how to take compliments. But thank you very much for joining me today.
You are a gentleman. Thank you very much, Billy.